Hey, morning. We're still waiting for a couple of more people and then we start, or maybe 3 more minutes and then we can start. Sif, I think Sonja activated your mic if you want to talk, feel free.
Nice. I don't think people can see me, right? No.
Don't think so, yes.
No. But yeah, I will wait a little bit and then welcome everyone. How are you, Sasha?
Oh, well, weather is bad again, unfortunately.
Yeah, I know. I don't know what's going on. But then the weekend looks promising, so that's always good.
Yeah, looking forward to it.
Yeah.
So I think 2 minutes and 1 minute and then we can start. So people still joining here.
Yeah, it's a different tool, so I think probably people have to download it and then.
Exactly. Register download maybe takes a couple of minutes.
Yeah. I think we can probably start, right?
Yes, sounds good.
So, hi everyone. You can't see me. We're using a different conferencing, a different tool from Do IT. I'm Sif. I'm the community manager here at the AI Campus, and thank you everyone for joining us today. We have our partner Do IT with us today. Sasha, machine learning engineer at Do IT, is gonna talk about automated machine learning. Sasha, I'll hand it over to you to introduce yourselves and the topic that you want to talk about today.
Thanks. You should see my screen, right?
Yes, we see it.
Good. Hey, folks. Great to be here. I really enjoy this tech lunch events. Always looking forward to it, Friday. Yeah, and thanks for taking your time today. Before I start, I think is it possible to raise hands here? I don't see it. Well, maybe not. Yeah, go to the next slide. My name is Sascha. I'm located in Berlin and I work at DoIt, a remote first company, and we help customers with everything around machine learning, cloud, and Kubernetes. So if you have any questions, you can ping me in the AI Campus Slack or reach out to me on LinkedIn, or you can use here the GoToWebinar and post your questions. We can cover them at the end. Today's talk is all about AutoML or automated machine learning, and we cover some of the basics of AutoML, but certainly not a deep dive. I talk about some of the use cases and best practices, and I share with you some of the most common services and frameworks. And finally, we do a live demo with Google AutoML tables. Fingers crossed for the live demo, see how it works. Yeah, this is something we all know, I assume. I call it handcrafted machine learning. And usually there are quite some steps required, like collecting and analyzing the data, doing pre-processing, like cleaning the data and feature engineering. And we have to select the right architecture and hyperparameters. And we have to train and serve the model, which both require infrastructure. And the biggest part, we need to make it repeatable. And those aspects are usually a lot back and forth. And we can spend a significant amount of time doing a lot of experiments here. And it's not unusual that teams need sometimes weeks, months for this process. And automated machine learning is there to automate some or even all of those steps. So with that, what is AutoML? According to Google, it's about training high quality machine learning models with minimal effort and expertise. And I would like to highlight minimal effort because it's not necessarily about missing expertise, but it's always about effort. And I get to that later when we talk about the use cases of AutoML. The next one is a less technical description written by O'Reilly. AutoML focuses on automating every aspect of the machine learning workflow to increase efficiency and democratize machine learning. And I think this is a great summary of AutoML, giving everyone, also the non-experts, the ability to apply machine learning to their problems and increase the efficiency no matter how experienced your teams are. And with that in mind, I would like to present my minimalistic definition of AutoML. Data in and model out, that's what it is. It's supposed to be simple, just simple, and major contributions in form of research and achievements in AutoML have been taking place in the last years, and AutoML is nowadays a hot topic and is receiving much attention from industry, even more attention from research, and even attention from general public, like companies like we are all supporting here and in the chat here. And with that in mind, let's have a look at some of the building blocks of AutoML. And the next slide is by no means a complete list. It will certainly change a lot in the next years, and it might be also missing some topics, depends on which topics you're working. I want to give you with this slide a rough overview, but keep in mind, from a user perspective of AutoML, it should hide all this technical depth we see on this slide here. It should be simple in usage. This is why we call it AutoML. We want to extract away all the complicated parts and make it automatic. And anyway, let's have a look at this at AutoML in a nutshell here. Actually, any task trying to automate parts of the machine learning workflow can be considered AutoML. And AutoML tries to encapsulate steps we usually do manually. And all you can see here is the result of teams doing amazing research work. And we could talk days about this slide and each of the topics. And there's a lot of research happening. But today's talk is less about the latest research topics. It's more about AutoML from a practical use case. And the first building block we can see here, I go over each block, maybe less than a minute for each block. Feature engineering, also the process of transforming data into features that better represent the underlying problem. And this can be tedious and time consuming. And automating this step can save teams a lot of time and a lot of struggle. The next one is model selection. So we have to choose among a wide range of models our candidates, and that one that fits best to our problem. And this is not certainly only about the model performance, right? It's also how long does it take to train the model and how easy it is to understand and explain the model. So it's not only performance. Model selection does not only include finding the right types of models to use. It can also include architecture search to find specific structures of model architectures that fit best to your problem. And neural architecture search got quite some heavy research, and we are planning to do an additional session around that. I have a slide after that and can come back to it. The next one is finding the right hyperparameters, because they highly impact the performance of your algorithm, of your model. And we can do that based on intuition or experience, but this requires usually repeating the process until we are satisfied with the results. So we have to optimize, change hyperparameters, test, train the model, test again and again. And yeah, it's a repeating process. And automated hyperparameter tuning uses methods such as gradient descent or evolutionary algorithms to search for the best hyperparameters. So we don't have to do that manually based on our intuition or experience. And we obviously need to train, and AutoML products should take care of provisioning the right infrastructure, scale it in the right manner in order to train your models at a larger scale or efficient as possible. And after the training is completed, we have steps like evaluation to understand how well the model performed on a specific data set, explainability to be able to explain how the data relates to the model and the prediction it makes, like feature importance and the topics Katerina already presented earlier this week with her responsible AI talk. This goes into the same direction. And monitoring. So we have to keep track of our model while it's in production. We need to understand when is the time to train our model new because the data has changed, for example. And finally, we want to use our model in an automated fashion. So we don't want to take care of infrastructure, scaling, or availability. We just need an API endpoint we can give to our development teams, and they can use it to put it into production, into our products. And as you can see here on the slide, all of those steps require infrastructure. So you need to scale each of those steps, from feature engineering, if you do it at large scale, to training, of course, to tuning, and finally, obviously, to serving, because then it goes out into production and you get a heavy load on your model. And this is where we see a lot of customers struggling deploying their models to Kubernetes and spending a significant amount of time, which would be better used to focus on products. It, of course, depends on the company. If you're very experienced with Kubernetes, this is perfectly fine. But if you are a smaller company, or you want to iterate quick, or you don't have experience in Kubernetes, this is, might be not the best way to use it. And I show you later how you can deploy a model at large scale into production with just one click. Yeah, as you could see, there are quite some topics involved. And one particular interesting topic is neural architecture search. And together with Google, we are planning a session where we talk a little bit more about neural architecture search, some of the inner workings of Google AutoML, and we want to cover some of the latest research topics. This is planned for beginning of July. I think we keep you updated in the AI Campus Slack and maybe in the newsletter as well. Yeah, now a little bit more about where and why AutoML, so the use cases we can cover. So we saw machine learning consists of manual steps, very manual steps, and those are error prone and tedious tasks, and using AutoML introduces some kind of reproducibility and reduces the chances of errors. All the error prone tasks are basically abstracted away into those AutoML products, so we don't have to take care of that on your own. It is already implemented. Someone took care of it. Someone qualified those steps. And this reduces the chances, the errors we could make if we automate the step. Obviously, if you have a limited machine learning expertise or you have a small team, this is also a great fit. We see companies with no ML department deploying successful AutoML solutions into productions. And though there is still some experience of machine learning required, and I can show you that in the demo later, but it's a very limited amount and you can get into it in a couple of days. But even if you're not experienced, you can use it for proof of concepts or to build a baseline model. You maybe want to compare with your already existing handcrafted model. This is what a lot of customers do. They have already a trained model. They may be struggling with optimizing the performance. And we usually recommend try AutoML, see how AutoML performs. Maybe it's even better than yours. And you can get insights out of that because AutoML shows you AutoML tables, for example, which model it took, and this can give great insights into your implementation later. And of course, you can use it in production, so you can quickly launch ML products with good quality by keeping the maintenance and implementation efforts low because everything is automated. So there's no need to have a large team to invest weeks of implementation, choosing the right model. It's very quick and it has a good quality. And of course, using products like Google AutoML keeps your model state of the art because Google is taking care of always optimizing their products and introducing new capabilities like the latest model architecture or other advanced features and research topics. So you don't have to be always on top of the latest research. You don't have to struggle to maybe implement the latest research paper you found. This is Google doing for you and doing it in a way that you can ensure that your model never gets worse than it was before. It usually gets better. And of course, you can just give it a try if you're generally interested. It's a quick solution, as you can see later. But there's a lot of skepticism about AutoML, and I cannot understand it fully. AutoML is not a competitor for you. It certainly will not take away your job. Think of it as an automation to free up your time. You can use for more important things. But even more as an automation, I like to think of AutoML as just another tool in our toolbox, today's topic of this talk. And it's usually the first tool I use when I approach new ML cases. So you can take your raw data, the data as it is in your CSV, in your BigQuery, in your database, and put it into AutoML, wait a couple of hours, and you get a model. It might be the one you're using in production, but it doesn't have to be. So if you're not convinced, take your TensorFlow or PyTorch model and compare it against your AutoML model. You maybe lose a couple of bugs, not much, but a bit, but you certainly gain knowledge. And maybe the model is even better than you handcrafted and you can save you a lot of stress, time, and money as well. And now I cover some of the AutoML products currently available. And there are various AutoML services and frameworks. And the features and capabilities differ a lot. That's something you need to be aware of. Not all the products are the same. And not all the products cover the whole spectrum of AutoML. So the slide we had in the beginning, not all products have everything of it. Some services focus on a usage with a user interface, simple UI, where others are accessible programmatically or even both. And the first thing we can distinguish between are cloud services like the products from Google, AWS, and Azure, and open source frameworks available. And sometimes there even exist open source frameworks that come out of products like Google AutoML. And secondly, we need to distinguish between implementation of efforts required to use those AutoML tools. For example, Google AutoML does not require a single line of code to train and get a ready-to-use API prediction endpoint. In comparison, most of the frameworks need implementation, as you would do in any other project. Google has a comprehensive set of extremely easy to use AutoML products, well-designed user experience, and an excellent result for many ML use cases. And I don't say that because there's Google Cloud on the slide. I say that because I'm really a big fan of the Google AutoML products, because I think they go into the right direction. They are very easy to use and they abstract away a lot of the steps. They are very expensive usually and hard to understand. And I'm almost certain every one of you has at least some data ready to use with one of those AutoML products or services. Google covers a wide range of different data types, image classification and object detection with AutoML Vision, video classification and object tracking in videos with AutoML Video Intelligence, and just typical natural language stuff like text classification, entity extraction, sentiment analysis with AutoML natural language, all trained on your custom data. This is important, all trained on your custom data. Those are not ready to use APIs. You take your own data and train your custom model on it. Then classification and regression on structured data with AutoML tables. This is what we cover today, a classification use case with AutoML tables on structured data. And there are stuff like custom translations. If you have a very specific use case and the translations are wrong, then you can use AutoML translation or even recommendations with Google's recommendations AI. So bear with me a couple of more slides and then we get to the live demo. But let me first set the right expectations. And what we want to achieve with AutoML is a competitive quality. AutoML can outperform handcrafted models, but don't always expect to be top one quality, at least yet. And our customers, we see AutoML outperforming handcrafted models, but not in all cases. And this is something which directly correlates to the experience and the budget of the teams. So if you have a team with highly researched, concentrated people, they might manage to deliver top one quality, maybe in short time. Maybe your team is small and you don't have this budget, then AutoML might be also the right choice for you. And keep in mind, competitive does not only relate to the performance of the model, but even more important is how quick can you put new models into production? How quick can you take an idea and put it outside ready to use for your customers? Just remember, I said it already, but I will say it probably a couple of times more. You just take your data, wait a couple of hours, and you get ready to use API. And there's one thing I want you to remember. Things are simple until you make them complicated, and this quote is not for me. You could develop a handcrafted machine learning solution, but is it really necessary? Why don't invest a couple of hours into AutoML and see what the results are before you invest months or weeks into your custom solution? You will lose a couple of hours, that's it. And with that in mind, let's do some demo. But before we start in the demo, I have two or three more slides. So the data set I use today for this demo is tabular data consisting of, I think, 30 feature columns. And the data is part of an experiment at the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland, and where they detected the Higgs boson. I think most of us know this particle as the God particle. And there is no further knowledge of the Higgs boson required to follow the next steps. This is official Kaggle competition, and you can download the data set directly from Kaggle. This is why I chose this, and I'm a big fan of the stuff. So it was quite interesting. And the best Kaggle submission, if you have Kaggle competitions, you can make submissions. And this is already a little bit older data set. But the best Kaggle submission achieved a classification accuracy of 84%. And during the demo, we can actually see that Google AutoML tables final model is a gradient boosting decision tree. And this is exactly the same like the best Kaggle submission used. And we achieve a similar performance result on this data set, which is quite interesting. One thing before we go to the demo, Google AutoML tables runs training jobs simultaneously for different models, like you can see on the right side of the slide. And in fact, it uses 92 N1 standard four machines, which is the equivalent of around 300 CPUs and over 1000 gigabyte of memory, just to find the right model for your AutoML table dataset. This is quite a lot. And with that in mind, we have a look at the pricing after the demo. And one fun fact, because I'm good in time, and the Higgs boson is by no means a godlike particle, like you hear it. Maybe you heard it already in the news a couple of years ago, but it's an important one. And Leo Lederman, who tried to detect this particle, referred to it as a goddamn particle just because it was so hard to detect. And the media took it, and now everyone knows it as the God particle. Just a fun fact on the side. So better call it Higgs boson, because this is how it should be called. And the cat again, that means we head over to the demo, and after the demo, we come back and talk a little bit more about some prospectuses and can cover some of your questions if you have some. Don't forget to post them here in the GoToWebinar. So this is Google Cloud Platform, and I currently am inside of Vertex AI. Vertex AI was just released a couple of weeks ago as part of the last Google conference. It basically took all the Google products and put them together into one combined product with some new additional features on top. So we are state of the art here today. And everything usually starts with a data set. Like always, we need some kind of data. And in that case, I have already a data set because I uploaded it, but we can create a new one. And we call it an Exposon AI Campus. And this is tabular data, it's a CSV file. And we want to do regression, and forecasting is also new. And we can want to do a classification on this data set. We could choose here, for example, different locations if we want to store the data in Europe, for example, for some kind of appliance, for some kind of security reasons or appliance reasons. And then we can click create. So we create this data set. This takes a couple of seconds. And then we can upload your data, our data. And uploading you can do for this data set, because it's a tabular data set. It's obviously first thing CSV, which comes in mind. Or you can use BigQuery if you want to put your data into BigQuery. You can use this as well, like some data you get from your website, click behavior, stuff like that. And I uploaded the file already to Google Cloud Storage. This is a Higgs boson data set, the training CSV. And now we can click continue. And again, takes a couple of seconds, very quick. What we see here is the CSV and the columns of this data set. You see we have 33 columns, and those are mostly floating values. And we have a label, which is the target which we want to predict. So is the signal from those sensor data indeed a Higgs boson, or is it background noise? So it's called background or signal, so B or S for the label. And then we have a weight. I come back to that later. And what we could do here, we could generate some statistics. And this takes a couple of minutes. That's why I already prepared this data set. So I clicked on generate statistics to get some of those values, like distinct values, and how many missing, and we can get some insights into the data itself. So if we go back to the already prepared data set, because they are already created the statistics, and here you can see we have 250,000 rows in this data set, and you can see the distinct values. And in event ID, you could see, oh, okay, we have 250,000 different values. Maybe this is some kind of identifier. And this might be not necessarily important for our model. So we keep that in mind for later. And this is something you have to do with your domain knowledge. You have to look over it, understand, okay, maybe they're missing values, why they are missing, is this important? Is this important that they are missing? Maybe this influenced your model accuracy. So you still need your domain knowledge, and you have to apply it here. And now with that, we also can click on it, and you see the distribution here of the data. And we also see the labels, which is B for background and S for signal for the detected boson. And now we can train a new model. And we take our data set, we say it's the classification, and we want to use AutoML. So you don't necessarily have to use AutoML. You could also use a custom training, like your TensorFlow or your XGBoost or your PyTorch code, and run the training on this data set using your custom code. But today it's about AutoML. That's why we choose AutoML here. And now we have to predict our target column. So what do we want to predict? This is the label. And here you can split your data. So for this use case, for the sake of simplicity, we use random assignments. So 80% for training, 10 for validation, and 10 for testing. We could also use manual assignment, by defining training validation as value as a column in our data set. If we have more deeper knowledge, we could use that. Or chronological assignment if your data is somehow time series biased. So this helps to handle that. So in our case, we take random assignment, and now we are here in this user interface. This is where you have to apply your domain knowledge. So I know event ID is an identifier, are not necessarily important for our model, so I exclude it here from training. But you also have to check if the transformations Google detected here, this is an automatic process, are correct. So you have to go over it. For example, if you have some categorical values and this is marked as numeric, you have to change it to make your model right. There are different types supported. I get to the details later, what kind of types are supported, but in general, it's categorical text and timestamp and numeric and arrays of those. So multiple values in one column. So what we can do, we have advanced features here. And because this is a binary classification problem, we choose our quark in that case. And the good thing is the creator of the data set provided some rating where they rated in D2 rows for this data set. And this is a nice feature, which is quite useful, and we can use that. And that's all. We now have our data. We have looked over it. We excluded something which should not be part of the training. And we can continue. And now we're here at the budget interface. So if we hover over this question mark, we can see Google's recommendations on the training hours required. In our case, we had 250,000 rows, and Google recommends to train between 1 and 6 hours. So what we can do now, this is a recommendation, and you usually can rely on that. So, but maybe you're not trustful enough, you can choose also 8 hours and enable early stopping. So if the model detects the performance is not improving further, it will stop. Maybe after 1 hour, maybe it takes the full 8 hours. It depends on the data and on the structure of your data. And now we can click Start Training. And Google is now provisioning in the background everything Google needs to train this model. So it's provisions, these machines I already mentioned. You can see here a summary, and you can keep track, live tracking on your model performance here. And at some point you get an email, the model is done, then you can come back. So imagine the model is already done. I already trained it. So we can head over to the already trained model, and it will look like that. You get the evaluation tab where you can see the scores. In our case, the F1 score, because the data set is not fully balanced. We have a little bit more background than signal. So F1 score is probably better to choose than accuracy. And we have a F1 score of 0.84, which is quite good for this data set. You get a confusion matrix out of the box to see, okay, which one maybe got wrong predict. This is important if you work on data sets where those wrong one predicted labels might be important. Maybe not, depends on the data set. And you also get the feature importance. And this is again where you have to apply your domain knowledge and understand, okay, yeah, it makes sense that this feature is very important for the model. Maybe there is a feature which is not part of your prediction data, and it gives you wrong information to the model. You could see it here as well. Then we can deploy and test our model. So this is the area where you indeed do something with your trained model. So we could either export it as a TensorFlow model, which you then can take, deploy to Kubernetes, or even to Cloud Run if you want to run it in a serverless environment. This is pretty well. And you also can run tests on your model. So in that case, those are the values our model awaits and at prediction, and we can predict. And for those sample values, we get background noise for confidence of 60%. And we can simply deploy our model now by clicking deploy to endpoint. We have to define an endpoint name. And we have to define a number of nodes. So depending on the requests you get, depending on the load you get on your prediction endpoint, you can define how large can scale. So you can define a maximum budget if you want to take care of your costs and not scale unlimited to 100 of machines. You could define here 5, for example, and the machine type. And we usually recommend to leave this empty. Minimum is anyway 1. And leave this also on standard. Then you deploy your model. And then you take your estimated number of requests and do some load testing on it. And then you have an interface, I'll show you that later, where you can see in the number of requests the model can process in which amount of time, and then you can adapt it. Maybe you can downscale. Maybe you need to upscale. And you also get understanding of how many nodes they are actually running to get maybe the traffic spikes managed. And then you can define, okay, if we have traffic spikes, we usually don't have more than 10 nodes, then you can define 10 here. And in case of any attack on your API, you're on the safe side here, so it doesn't scale unexpectedly to something like that in the background. So, and now we can, that's it here. Now we can choose the region. This is based on the data set and the model was trained on, so you have to take care of that previously. And now we can deploy it. And this takes a couple of minutes again. And because it takes a couple of minutes, I already prepared this endpoint. If we click on it, you can see the metrics. So you get the predictions per second, the model is processing, the error percentage, the requests per second, and the response codes, and stuff like latency, where you can keep track of your model. Is it good enough? Maybe you need to optimize, stuff like that, with this interval here. So pretty easy. And you also can have a look at the sample request. So for example, if you use a REST API endpoint, you need to authentication header and bearer token here in that case. And then you simply send an post request to this endpoint where you define your endpoint ID. This is what you see here, the project ID and your input. So your values you want to predict in that case. So really easy to use. There's also a Python endpoint and there are a couple of more client libraries available. And if we go back to the models, there's one important thing. We can do batch predictions. So if we don't have the need to deploy it as an API, so if you want to do batch predictions once a month, once a day, once a week, you can do that here as well. And Google is taking care of provisioning the right infrastructure, taking your batch prediction and stores it either in BigQuery or again to Google Cloud Storage. Pretty useful. You don't have to deploy in an environment as Google doing for you. And the more important thing, we have model properties. And here you can see, I defined a budget of 8 hours. And actually the model training time was 5 hours, 8 minutes, so even 1 hour less than Google already recommended for this size of data set. And you see optimized for our quark, but even more importantly, we can have a look at the model hyperparameters. So it's not a black box at all. If you go into the model hyperparameters, you can see what kind of type and what kind of hyperparameters Google choose to for this specific training data set. And this is Stackdriver and deployed a couple of days ago, so I have to go back in time. And here it is. Keep in mind, Stackdriver is per default stored for 30 days. So better have a look directly after training. At some point, this information is lost here. And we can look at the last model which was chosen, and this is a gradient boosted decision tree, so exactly the same as the winning submission of the Kaggle competition. And you even see the hyperparameters here chosen for the specific data set, which gives quite some good insights. And you could take this information and take it to your custom model if you want. Yeah, so and with that, I think we covered a lot here. There are some additional features, and if we go back to the model, if you go to the endpoints, this is a new feature where we released recently. We can monitor our endpoints. So we keep track of the data which comes in and compare to the data the model was trained on. And if the data starts to diverge from each other, we get notifications and we are aware we need to retrain. This is very useful. I can send you the links later on in the Slack channel to that. Very, very useful feature. So, and if we go back to the slides to cover some of the best practices, just 1 second. I have to resize the window a bit. So now back to the pricing. The time required to train the model depends on the size and the complexity of the training data. So early stopping, as we can see, can be activated to ensure the training stops when no additional improvements are possible. And except for AutoML tables, the price is around $3 per training hour. And AutoML tables looks like it is expensive compared to the others, but keep in mind the time you save when using AutoML. And from our customers, we see most AutoML use cases require less than 6 hours, which is approximately $130. I think that sounds fair, right? So especially when you take into account that we are using 92 machines here in parallel, and compared to the cost you have to spend to pay your team salary and stuff like that, it's basically nothing, $130 to get an initial modding, which has a very good quality. And now some of the best practices, and because this is very important, your domain knowledge is essential, as we saw during the demo, to build high quality models. So import your data, have a look at the data, have a look at the types Google detected, and look for suspicious values, suspicious outliners, and apply your domain knowledge. Don't be blind, just take the knowledge you have it and apply it to the AutoML tools as well. Take your time and read the documentation. The documentation is fully packed with very useful information, and it helps you to understand what AutoML expects from you to deliver the best results. There's a page full of best practices, like avoiding missing values, how to avoid bias, how to provide a time signal. Go through it, this is very important, and this helps to improve the AutoML performance even further. And this is where you need at least some kind of understanding of machine learning. You have to choose the optimization objective. So in our case, we used our quark because it's a binary classification problem. But if you have a highly imbalanced data set, maybe an optimized objective would be better for you. And this is where you need at least some kind of understanding of automated machine learning. Then I usually recommend to build a baseline model. So if you use AutoML, it's extremely important to have some kind of comparison. Train an AutoML model on your raw data without any further or additional feature engineering, at least for your baseline model. I commonly see customers doing feature engineering and then start AutoML, start a training on this feature engineered data, and then they think, okay, what have we could maybe optimize better, and they don't have this baseline model on the raw data. So the information is lost. Take the raw data, train your model, and if you're confident with your domain knowledge, you can further improve the model by doing additional pre-processing or feature engineering, do that, but after the baseline model, because then you are able to compare it. This is very important to get an understanding of the behavior of your feature engineering you do. And avoid already applied transformations. Google is already doing a lot of pre-processing, and there is, as I already mentioned, with the documentation, a lot of data preparation steps documented, like what is Google doing with numeric values? Bucketizing, for example. How is it working with categorical data? How is it working with text? Is it using some kind of lowercase? Does it tokenization? What is with stop words, stuff like that? And arrays, timestamps. So read this. This is also very, very important to understand what kind of transformation is already applied, and avoid them. If you indeed want to do pre-processing on your own feature engineering, just be sure to avoid that stuff Google is already doing for you, because this could influence the model of the performance of your model into the bad direction. And there is some, this is very important, some information where you have to do manual work, and this is where you have to make information explicit, like longitude, latitude, URLs, or IP addresses. This is stuff you have to do on your own if this is indeed part of your data set. Anyway, if you have email addresses as part of it, be sure there is no sensible data in it. That's it for with AutoML. I hope I could give you some insights in it. If you have any questions, please reach out to me on the Slack channel. We have a couple of upcoming talks prepared, like move models from research into production. This is where we dive deep into TensorFlow Extended and the inner workings of it. So this is really interesting topic. The second one is about MLOps, mostly on how you deploy your organize your workflow, ML workflows. And this is we want to do that with Kubeflow, TensorFlow Extended, and the really nice and newly released feature of Google Vertex Pipelines. It's basically a managed version of pipelines. Where you don't even have to take care of any Kubernetes stuff like that. Really cool. Then a quick approach to customizable machine learning, really where you take your handcrafted models and train it in the cloud and deploy to Cloud One. This is very useful for small companies or for POCs. And the last one, because it's always a topic our customers are heavily requesting, is how to optimize PyTorch and TensorFlow for GPUs, performance and cost-wise. And we improved customers' training from 60 images per second to almost 2,000 images per second training. And this is quite some factor which saves you time and a lot of money. And if you're particularly interested in one of those topics, let us know and we can make either a tech talk again, or we can make a session with you directly, have a look into your environments and help you to optimize. Time for some Q&A. And I think we share with you the recordings and the slides, so you have everything we talked about to share with your teams, to share with your colleagues. And thanks for your time. It was fun. Looking forward to some questions here. Yeah, if this is not working with the questions here, I never tried it, to be honest, just write me in Slack or write me on LinkedIn. This is also fine. Also happy to jump with you on a call to discuss some of the topics or to answer your questions later. Okay, no questions so far. And thanks again for your time. And soon as we can, so enjoy your weekend, hopefully with a little bit more sun. And see you next time. Thanks a lot. Bye bye.